Our brain is truly marvelous. Billions of neurons communicating each fraction of a second. The question is, how could it evolve? Welcome to Psyched. When wondering how the brain evolved, a crucial first question is, why do we have a brain at all? This question is not trivial. A multitude of organisms, very successful organisms, do not have a nervous system, let alone a brain. Plants, grasses, and trees dominate the landscape without ever sending a single action potential. Fungi thrive in treacherous environments, requiring not a single brain cell. And arguably, the most successful of all, bacteria, they dominate the world, and even live inside us. They require no nervous system. So why then did we evolve a brain? As is true for each species, only those will survive that adapt to their environment. Plants, for example, have developed a lifestyle that requires photosynthesis, using sunlight and water. As such, they require no movement. However, in an ever-changing environment, most animal species have found a different tactic to cope with the challenge to survive. Their strategy, altering their immediate environment by shifting location. In other words, by moving from one place to another, dangers can be avoided and more nutritional resources can be exploited. To be able to react to the environment by relocation requires a means to induce movements, that is, muscle fibers. And those muscle fibers need to be contracted. These contractions and relaxations of the muscle are governed by some type of network, a network of nerves. Indeed, the first and simplest proto-brains were nothing more than a net of some hundreds or thousands of neurons. These systems are called nerve nets, and they can still be found in modern species of jellyfish and anemones. Despite its simplicity, these nerve nets combine a sensory and a motor modality. Nerve endings sensitive to touch were almost directly coupled to motor neurons that induce a contraction of a muscle. Thus, a sense of touch would cause a reflex of a movement to avoid potential predators. To see how such simple networks can translate a sensation of touch to movement, we don't need to look far, even in our own bodies. There are simple networks called reflex arcs. Most of you will recognize, for example, the knee-jerk reflex. So when you go to the doctor's office and the physician hits the correct spot below your knee with a little hammer, an automatic movement of the lower leg follows. In this case, the sensation of touch directly translates to a movement. The signal travels from the skin to the spinal cord, and via a small number of intermediate neurons, a direct signal is sent to the muscle. None of these signals ever reaches the brain. Now, although nerve nets of jellyfish and reflex arcs in humans are very different from each other, they do demonstrate how simple networks containing only a small amount of neurons can combine touch and movement. Over time, animals evolved from radial symmetry, like jellyfish and anemones, to a bilateral symmetry. Bilateral symmetry refers to all animals that look symmetrical from left to right. Most of the bilateral animals do also have a top end, which we would refer to as a head. Together with the evolution of bilateral symmetry, neurons started to group together in a bundle, often in the head. These neuron bundles are called ganglia and are basically the same thing as a brain. However, we typically only use the word brain for vertebrate animals. In other words, animals with a spinal cord. The brains of animals without a spinal cord, such as insects, are typically called ganglia. Despite the centralization of neurons into a single bundle, their function stayed the same. Reaction to touch and producing movement. This becomes clear when looking at modern species of sea squirts. In their juvenile state, they much resemble tadpoles and move around freely. Yet, when reaching the adult stage, they settle into one place by biting themselves into a rock. This provokes a metamorphosis to the final adult stage. During this transformation, the sea squirt consumes most of its ganglion. In other words, it eats its own brain. Why? Well, since in its adult stage it does not require to move anymore, it does not need its brain. This example in modern species, which are basically living fossils, show that a simple brain is primarily used for movement. However, over time, one thing did change. Whereas touch and movement are coupled in a reflex loop in jellyfish, species that evolved later developed autonomous movement. This means that the organism is able to move without the presence of touch. So what's the advantage of that? Well, if you can move freely, this allows you to hunt for prey. In the next episode, we will take a deeper look into the brains of the first hunters. We hope you enjoyed the first episode, and we hope to see you the next time. Bye-bye.